Okay, well, in journalism, time is of the essence. Frequently, media is referred to as having something called a shelf life. So I jumped into this without doing a lot of research into it, but I wanted to answer the question that was posed by Alex Jones yesterday about how the Saturday Night Live skit, which effectively accused Donald Trump of pointing to black people and calling them aliens, and among other things, being a coward and things like that. And Alex Jones said something that was really important, which got me started on something I wanted to do with rhetoric, something much in a much more grand kind of a scheme. And this is called irony. And so the issue is about the calling things by opposite names. And he brought that up. So this comes from Aristotle. And so I did the gnothi sauton and did it myself the way it ought to be done, so that I know what this says. Instead of, I got a cheapo version right here, Harvard University Press, H. Rackham translation, Rhetoric to Alexander. It took me a while because I was just kind of like, where did this come from? I knew. Okay, so I'm going to walk you through this in the Greek. And this is the word ironia, irony. So this is ironia de esti legen pros poi umenon main legen a tois enantiois onomasi ta pragmata prosag or umine. Aristotle, Rhetoric to Alexander, this is the reference for you if you want to find it yourself. So this is a feminine dominant singular irony. It's defined in Little Scott's dictionary as being dissimulation or assumed ignorance. But this definition here is actually a contrary to what you're going to find in the lexicon. So this says, but irony, but irony is, esti is, this is a present active infinitive of lego. It says an infinitive, you translate it as saying. So irony is saying. Pros poi umenon. Pros poi umenon. Neuter, singular, present, middle passive, participle of pros poieo, to pretend. So this means to pretend. To pretend. Right? Irony is pretending to say, right? In the present active infinitive of lego, to say, is pretending to say, it's being a participle, as an ing, I, pretending. Pretending to say, not saying. So, irony is pretending to say something one is not saying. Okay, that's the first half of it. The second half pertains more to the question that Alex Jones addressed yesterday. A tois enantiois onomasi ta pragmata prosagor uain. So this is a dative. This is a dative plural. Neuter dative plural. Neuter dative plural. Enantiois. What is enantiois? Is the neuter dative plural of enantios, which means opposite. Opposite. This is onomasi is names. Also, this is also an interdative data plural. Opposite names. All right. Irony is pretending to say what one is not saying. Or ta pragmata prosagor uing. Present active infinitive of prosagor uo. So this is, which means to call. So this is calling pragmata. This is important right here. This is where the falling down comes in these cheapo texts. This is why you want to do it yourself. Because this is a neuter plural. Pragmata by its pragmata is neuter plural of pragma, which is a deed or a circumstance. However, in the plural, it can also mean affairs. In the plural, it means state of affairs. Affairs, right? Calling the state of affairs, this is an accusative. By opposite names. Calling the state of affairs by opposite names. That's exactly what SNL did to you and to Donald Trump. And they say that STEM is better, but this, we're talking about, Mr. Jones brought up this and called it weaponized rhetoric. Calling things by their opposite names. Now some people think that irony is some sort of funny ha-ha kind of joke, but really it's not. This comes from rhetoric to Alexander. This is one of the things that was taught to Alexander the Great as a boy, and one of the reasons that Aristotle was so greatly blamed by the Athenians and had to flee into exile, because of this second part, calling the state of affairs by opposite names, right? Okay, so there's more to it than that. I have something in Plato's Republic, which deals with irony. I did it myself, as I'm supposed to. I'm not gonna go through the entire Greek because it'll take too long, but it might be brought up. Because some people say that that irony is feigned ignorance, and that Socrates is repetitively accused in all of these authors of being an ironist. Socrates is accused of being an ironist repetitively. If you look in up in the internet and look for books or something. But that's not true. Socrates did not call things by their opposite names. He's accused in the Republic, Plato, Republic, 337A, more or less towards the beginning. And he's in this argument with Thrasymachus, right? And so I'll give you the cheapo version. This is F.M. Cornford. This is the one that, one of the few that standard textbooks in the universities. So what he has here is he says, "Good Lord," he said, "Socrates at his old trick of shamming ignorance!" Exclamation point. I knew it. I told the others you would refuse to commit yourself and do anything sooner than answer a question. Now I'm not going to go through, I have the Greek right here. I did it myself, right? There and there. I'm just going to read you what my version is. Or maybe I'll write it down here. My version is this. My version says this. It says, this is the customary irony. This is the customary irony of Socrates, of Socrates. This is the customary irony of Socrates, and I knew this before. And I knew this beforehand. Right? And I knew this beforehand, that you are unwilling to answer. And feign ignorance and feign ignorance about nearly everything. Thing that you might be asked, that you might be asked. And so this is Republic 337. Okay, so this is quite a bit different than what you're going to get out of FM Cornford. This is just about exactly as close as you're ever going to get to what this says. Now, we have to keep in mind that just because Thrasymachus says this does not prove that Socrates does it. He says that he is feigning ignorance. And this is important here because you're going to hear this all the time about this guy Socrates. But the truth of the matter is that it goes back to something that he said in Theaetetus. It's in Theaetetus, I believe, where he discusses the process of the philosopher as being somewhat of a midwife. And so this so-called feigning ignorance is the Socratic method is to lead the student to the conclusion themselves instead of just telling them the answer outright. And so he does the question and answer, which is eventually supposed to cause the realization. It's the process of the self-discovery, because when you self-discover that way, you lay a firm hold of what it is instead of just regurgitating information that's been put into your brain. So, right, so the word here for feigning ignorance, let's see, feigning ignorance, okay, is feigning ignorance. thing, ignorance, is the word. Okay. I. I row. That's just the word here in the Republic, is this one. Soy. Soil. I don't know, soil. This is a future middle passive optive. Anyway, this is the word that is used to feign ignorance. The word, this is feigning ignorance. The word for irony is, well, I just had it on the board, right? Irony. That's a different word. It's not exactly the same word. So, it's related, but this is not the same word. This is the feign ignorance. So, what you find, though, is that this is the next thing I want to get to, is this. M. Buck 10. Right? M and Buck 10. Dialogic imagination. Dialogic. Imagination. In his book, Dialogic Imagination, M.M. Bakhtin refers to lampooning somebody as comic. Oops. Comic dismemberment. Now, I think it was David Knight or something brought up Saul Alinsky in his book Rule for Radicals, and it says don't underestimate the power of ridicule. It goes back a lot farther than that. This comic dismemberment, this is what was done to Socrates as a major step towards essentially assassinating him. Was comic dismemberment. And who did the comic dismemberment? Who did the comic dismemberment? But in clouds. Aristophanes repetitively on stage in Athens comically dismembered that man. And what does he do, among other things? Well, I didn't do this myself because I didn't have time. But I'll go from memory from somebody else's translation. And so it's kind of paraphrased. What did Aristophanes do? He put these words in Socrates' mouth on stage. And this is it. I remember the good old days. When we used to march the boys to school naked and forbid them to cross their legs until they grew proud of their manhood. Round about the time they got fuzz on their nuts. Aristophanes clouds. Calling things by their opposite names. Calling the state of affairs by an opposite name. Socrates was 100% against doing things like that. It's very clear in the apology. It's also made very, very clear in all Kibiades' speech in Plato. Alcibiades said that he tried to do everything he could possibly do to corrupt this man, Socrates, and Socrates threw his cloak over him and went to sleep because it was cold. And in the morning, he woke up and he found like he had a new father or an older brother. That makes it rather clear. What Socrates says in the Apology also makes it very clear that he was very much against this man-boy love. Man-boy love, you see? This is what the ironists do, you see. Man, boy. Yeah, you see. Let's see here. How do they do that, you know? Well, let's see here. Maybe it goes like that, you know? Something like that. Is that how they do it on the bathroom walls, right? They did some bathroom walls, they tried. I'm not gonna draw. Man, boy, love. Socrates is very profoundly against it. Aristophanes makes it very clear in the Clouds that he was for it. And Socrates names a number of men, a number of teachers. Now, Socrates wasn't taking money for teaching, but he very much saw himself as being a teacher. And this brings us to another state of affairs. It is because the teacher is like the father. Remember what Milo said about father so-and-so? See, I had one of these guys when I was in college, sweating, graduating. He called himself like being like my father. Yeah, see, I wouldn't do that. I didn't take the deal. I didn't take the deal, you see. I don't have any where I had to just click off on the little Milo thing there, because the intimacy between the teacher and the student is akin to the father thing. You're getting inside that kid's head in a very serious way. The power situation is not equal at all. I mean, I'm talking about college. I'm not talking about man-boy love with children. I'm talking about, you know, somewhere between 20 and 40 years senior. 20 to 40 years senior. These kids in college, 20 years old. You know, he's 40 years old. No, maybe he's 60. You know, maybe he's 60 years old. The kid's going to get a grade. You know, there's an exam coming, you know. Well, you see, so this is why that relationship between the teacher and the student can never have this kind of thing here. We don't do this. It's not allowed. But since he has tenure, he still has a job. So anyway, I found this little puzzle, and I was wondering if we should find Edward Snowden to come and help us all. But the truth is, this is geodesic here. I made a lot of these when I worked at the Buckminster Fuller Institute in Los Angeles. See, it's really simple. This is five, and these are six that go, six-sided goes around the five-sided. Forget what they call it. My memory's not so great. But anyway, so this, if I could work this last thing in, because I want to bring this up. That's why I brought this thing. Was because I want credit for this. History is a linear trajectory. See, history does not repeat itself. If we rely, for instance, on R.G. Collingwood, who wrote a book called The Idea of History, history is a circular motion, perhaps very flat, as how he puts it, perhaps a very flat spiral. But it's something which is always moving forward. So this is what I call it. I call it a spiral linear trajectory, which is a word I learned from this guy, Buckminster Fuller, who created these things. Spiral linear trajectory. This is history. History does not repeat itself, but we are able to find analogs. And so we're finding these analogs here, right? Right away we see the opposite things being done. We see comic dismemberment, effectively weaponized language, yeah. This rhetoric, and I'll get into this later, is why rhetoric is the most powerful thing in human hands. It can destroy people. So we see the spiral coming around, right? It's a spiral linear trajectory. History doesn't repeat itself, but it does, in a sense, go around in circles. That's why we study this stuff. This is why. See, the guy who tells me these things about I know in town, he teaches this book. He's an English teacher. Right. See, guys like me, we can't get a job doing things like that. You want to teach Plato, then you get an English teacher who's going to tell you that Socrates said, I know that I know nothing, that Socrates was an ironist, and then he's constantly just making a joke. See, this is part of how they call the things by its opposite, right? Saying that it's all a joke. They're the ones who are calling things by their opposites. Socrates was most certainly not doing that at all. Socrates was saying exactly what he meant to say. No question about that. Oops. Okie dokie. Over and out. See you next time.